am eternal, detained in the body of a man who didn't arrive by proper channels. I have no papers, no evidence, no proof I'm not a threat. My existence is another country, a private language few can speak. Do you understand? It is in my nature to cross borders. I am in transit. If I could show you what my life was like before I was born. I come from whispers and terrifying alliances. From the time I was four, a part of me didn't belong. I was with those who were outside. Anyone who has traveled this far and known this much danger must surely be the bearer of secret messages. I arrive with stories, genealogies of past lives and hidden families hardened by unspeakable crimes, loves that have lived and died. I do not want to stop the boats. I want bigger boats and better boats and hearts and minds whose wish is not to crush the souls of those that have been left behind. There's nothing quite as treacherous as another big lie or a politician in search of the next final solution. Where is the cue for lost causes? Asylum is not a place, but a borderless state of mind.
Whoa.
Welcome to the show, Billy Marshall Stoneking.
Hello.
Bernie.
Hello.
This is a really special edition of Get Go Today. Billy, thank you for writing this incredibly emotional and confronting and inspiring piece of work.
It was something that was, I was very aware of the fact that if we're going to do anything about the refugee situation, we have to understand how we are like refugees ourselves, because you can't really do anything if there isn't some kind of emotional identification and some connection that you feel that goes beyond politics.
Absolutely. And it's empathy, isn't it? It's just what I teach when I teach ethics at school. Like the biggest, and with my own children, the biggest thing is put yourself in someone else's shoes.
Yeah.
And that's why I get them to act out. You know, like put yourself in someone else's shoes, because unless it's your own family or your own personal experience, it seems to be a quality that we don't, in this Western world we live in, we don't really tend to reward empathetic thinking. We reward greed, and we reward
ambition.
Yeah. Well, thank you for sharing that with us, and welcome to Get Go Today.
Yeah, and there's a reason why we come up with Nauru pictures and asylum. There's a big news story just broke.
There is. Guardian Australia has just broken a massive story about Dr. Peter Young, who was the psychiatrist in charge of all of the he was actually the medical director of mental health for all of Australia's detention centres. He criticised the Australian government after a young Iraqi man died after an injury, and he believes that he wasn't looked after. He really is critical of the way all detainees are treated from a mental health perspective, number one. And he actually is a whistleblower, and we salute him. And The Guardian Australia has said that the AFP actually investigated him and tapped into his phone records.
Yeah.
And Dr. Peter Young found this out because of the law that you're allowed to... What's it
called? Well, there was that whistleblower law that the government enacted, what, last year? Was it with Tony Abbott?
Yes.
And everyone said, someone's going to use that like the Nazis did against people to shut them up. I said, oh, that won't happen. Well, it did fucking happen. Sorry, I got angry. But, you know, this is the government we have. They enact a law, and you know what?
But it's happening
and
in
maybe,
South Wales
and maybe,
as well.
And maybe Malcolm Turnbull didn't ask them to do that, and maybe Malcolm Turnbull didn't ask him to raid the Labor offices, but you've got a couple of little keen little people to please Malcolm, right? And the little, you know, the Hitler youth are willing to go out there and arrest people because the law says they can.
Yeah, exactly.
And you broke the law, you're in the wrong, but the law is wrong.
And if you're a whistleblower, we're just going to tap into all of your conversations, your privacy. We are actually going to, we're actually
this
not
country
gonna, I mean, it's really, it's terrifying.
I think it's rather disingenuous anyway that Malcolm Turnbull thinks that he can excuse himself by saying, well, I didn't really know.
He's the Prime Minister.
I mean, that's a condemnation of his leadership and a refusal to accept responsibility for the fact that he allows a climate to exist in Australia in which public servants feel that they have a right to do that and will be supported and defended because of that climate. The fact that he's given them permission tacitly to do that.
These people are slippery criminals. What they do is they set up something so other people will destroy it and do their dirty work.
They don't
get caught out. You know, drug dealers don't get caught dealing drugs. It's the little lackeys doing
it. It's the desperate mules.
You don't kill someone. There was this great criminal case actually that's been suppressed mainly in the media out back to Bankstown way, where some guy was killed for a drug deal, and they have a guy that prepares the gun and loads the bullet and a guy that pulls the trigger. The guy that pulls the trigger got off scot-free. I don't know why, but the guy who loads the bullet is in jail.
Yeah.
You know? So they have it all worked out so that they just... You know, the law is not for good people. The law is, the criminals love the law because we don't break it, they do. So they've got a free market.
Oh, so interesting. See? Well, all I say is thank God for whistleblowers. And Dr. Young is actually calling for people to be angry and defiant about attacks on whistleblowing.
Yeah, there's an article I posted on my Facebook site, which I recommend people go have a look at, called The Whistleblower's Manifesto.
Oh, okay.
And there's links to other sites that deal with, that talk about this in really intelligent and articulate ways. So if people are interested in looking at that, I recommend it.
Fantastic.
So that's a really good idea.
Yeah.
Whistleblower's Manifesto.
And share it around. The more people that read this, the better.
100%. Isn't Assange being called the most dangerous man in the world?
Yeah, there's just been a book put out about him. And in fact, we're hoping that we can do an interview with Julian Assange and Edward Snowden in the coming weeks. So
keep a lookout for that. Blow the whistle on this place.
Yeah.
Let's do it.
We got Marco coming in.
Is that a phone call coming? No, we've got. I'm Skyping
Marco.
Marco,
there he is.
Hey, g'day,
Nah. Hello, Marco. Oh, I'm sorry, I just lost you. Hang on, I'm coming back to you.
It's a button pushing.
It's my button pushing.
There it is. Yeah.
And you did give me a really good lesson.
More button
and
pushing.
No flipping.
I'm trying to get you, Marco. You gave me a lesson on how to make this awful screen, and can you believe I'm just not implementing that right now?
So it's okay because
you're good
at this end. So I'm not sure why our camera.
You're good. You just need to get a full screen. There we go. I just didn't want all of this stuff on the edge, but you know what?
There it is. Yeah.
Okay. Anyway, we're back. You're at Lincoln Center in New York City.
Correct. We're here at the Lincoln Center in central New York, sort of thing. Fantastic little location for us. Some beautiful buildings here. The odd feeling that we get at the Lincoln Center is that they were paid for by the Koch, I can never pronounce their name, Koch brothers.
Sort of
wealthy guys out of Texas who are fabulously wealthy sort of thing and love digging, burning oil, but they help fund these buildings now.
So that's why they were waiting for you.
Between two people, mm-hmm. should you come here and enjoy yourself. But three fantastic buildings, the Symphony Orchestra over this side, that you're sort of looking at now, and then the Opera House is what we're just standing in front of. We're about to head out in the rain.
Sit him out in the rain.
It's beautiful. That's
the other side is the ballet.
I was about to say there's the ballet school and the Juilliard School of Music. Is that right?
So the Juilliard School of Music, you're very, very good. The Juilliard School of Music is over this side.
She's virtually a New Yorker.
I'm half New Yorker.
Across there. So the students, although most of them probably can't afford to go to the symphony, although I guess maybe they get student passes.
Wow.
So fantastic location here, and we missed out, unfortunately, about half an hour ago. They were doing graduations here, so we had several thousand people suddenly appear here in the middle of the mall, but they've all gone home now. So it's now quiet, it's just us, but we're heading over towards the fountain at this stage. So we've got a couple of good topics to talk about. No pre-roll this week, but a couple of interesting things going on. So what's happening in Australia? Fill me in on the election.
All right. Well, I read this morning in the Herald that Trump and Clinton are neck and neck in the polls right now. So can we quickly talk a little bit of American politics before we talk about what's happening here?
Sure we can.
So how is that being reported in the States? Because it's quite big here.
So exactly the same way. So I don't know if you remember, but about 3 weeks ago, I predicted when Trump became the candidate that we were going to see exactly this happen. That they would build it, turn it into a, there's so many TV shows and talking heads and analysts who make their living off it's a race and we're going to talk about it every day. We knew that the polls were going to get almost even, and they have. So they're sort of doing that, and the Bernie supporters are saying, well, he's better off, he would beat Trump at the moment, But it's mainly because people don't necessarily see him as the person who will eventually win the Democratic candidacy. So it's getting reported here in the same way that it's a two-horse, you know, that either of them could win. And of course, what the real story is, and it gets reported here as well, is that both of them are really disliked. Like at the moment, I think at this point in the race, they're the most disliked candidates that America's had in an election since they started taking polls.
So that's got to tell you something about politics in general, doesn't it? That the people the most hated are being voted for because there's someone else that they hate more.
Exactly, they're getting selected. Right. So they're getting selected as the. It's a really strange system, right? But of the candidates, the other people were hated more.
Yes.
The other sort of Democratic and Republican candidates available. So anyway, it's going to be an interesting time, but I think for the next month or so, you know, until we get to Philadelphia actually it's in July, so it's not that far away, when we start seeing the conventions run, the story is just going to be, well, they're neck and neck, and who's winning this week, and so on, until they're finally the actual candidates. Then we'll start getting into the debates and the real race.
Right.
I noticed that Paul Ryan was in the news saying that he said that Trump could get elected, but he's not betting on it. I mean, that's a remarkable statement for the Speaker of the House of Representatives to make. He's not betting.
It's still that thing of, while they had their meeting and they all came out of the meeting saying we're all, you know, it's all good and we're seeing progress and so on. There is this aspect of that clearly, the interesting thing with Ryan is whether he still thinks he's in the race himself, whether he's setting himself up for the convention to be that candidate that, if it's clear in the polls that Trump won't win, the Republican Party will try and choose somebody else.
The senior GOP donors, the big money men, have evidently been turning their backs on Trump. It's also been reported in the last few days.
That's exactly it. So, not all of them. There's a lot of money. Sort of, there are people signing checks to Trump right now. But the interesting thing is that, you know, normally at this stage the candidate is raising funds for all of the other Republicans running at the, you know, the city level, the state level, in the both houses of Congress. But at this stage, most of them are sort of hoping that they'll see some of that money, but they don't necessarily want to stand up and associate themselves with Trump.
Yeah.
They're associating themselves with the GOP. It's a really interesting race, and you're seeing some of that on the Democrat side as well, just that pushing and shoving of, we don't know what's going on.
Well, you asked us, Marco, what's going on with our upcoming election, and the terrifying thing I was reading about this morning was that Pauline Hanson is actually right back in the mix. Did you know about that?
I thought she was dead.
I hope she's still around. Politically dead.
Now, you know what? There's an interesting documentary done about 2 years ago about the One Nation Party has been reformed. It's actually a business. It's owned by three people, and the people who are a member of the party have no say in the policies or anything. This has been set up so that she has a business that's going to put her into Parliament, and she'll have the balance of power, and she's for sale. And they've been planning this, and it's really, I'll get you the link. I'll put it at the bottom of the get-go thing. Because when you watch it, it's terrific. ABC going down there. You think she's a fruitcake? No, it's really, really serious. And the people running the business. Sorry. Oh, the cops.
So we're just talking to Australia. Do you want to talk?
Hello,
to
hello.
Hi there.
We'll wave again to. Hello.
How are you going?
Say hi.
Hello. Hi. We're in Bondi Beach.
Bondi. Hello.
We love New York.
You single?
Okay. Say hi to Sheena.
Hi, Sheena.
Hi. How you going?
Hey. When are you coming to Sydney?
Yeah.
When are you coming to Sydney, Sheena? They want you to visit.
That's how we get out of that. Yep.
she doesn't know, so they can only hear on this.
That's so funny. Yeah.
Okay.
Go under the wire.
Great place.
Yeah,
Marco, second week running that the police have been hovering around. I mean, all, you know, seemingly very innocent. And I'm sure Sheena's lovely. And I can understand why they want to know what you do, what you and Penny are doing there. But it's fascinating, right? Like, it happened at the Rockefeller Center.
Particularly as we're cabling up. Like, that's one of the things of, you know, we've got lots of little headphone wires and things.
The electrics.
And little lights going on. So they're like, what are you doing?
Yeah. Just don't put a button on your belt buckle, right?
So, yeah, I don't do up the coat. I, don't, I don't know if you saw the photo I put up on Facebook, but when we got here, there was like a dozen police cars.
Yes.
Okay.
That was for the graduate ceremony thing and all of that.
Yeah, yeah.
Anyway,
so back on track of this. So Pauline Hance is in the race again, which is, I guess I shouldn't be surprised, but there you go.
Yeah.
And I don't know if you guys saw, there was a story in the I think it was in the Australian Financial Times over the weekend. Like, I was surprised. It was talking about the number of millennial voters, you know, the new people coming out of school or college right now, who haven't enrolled to vote.
And they closed off last night.
They even faced a $20 fine if they don't enroll.
Yeah, they closed off last night, and they tried, some people tried to take that to the court to get that time extended because the election came upon us all of a sudden, and there's no instructions on how to sign up. So just like the Republicans in America, you know, the Liberal Party don't want young people because young people don't want them. And so they're manipulating the system, you know.
But do you think there's a whole thing that $20 is a fine, so what? I can't be bothered, everyone's corrupt. Do you think there's a little bit of that attitude as well going on for a lot of younger generation, the younger generation in this country?
They've got investment.
Apathy. You know, what do you think, Ben?
I think the next thing that's going to happen is that voting is not going to be compulsory in Australia, and it will be sold on the basis that it's undemocratic to force people to have an opinion about anything at all.
And that'll
be the thin edge of the wedge. America is going down the same road that America has been going down politically. Sorry, Australia. And so, a word to the wise is sufficient, but Australia is in love with America in ways that are so pathological, it sends chills up my spine.
It's because of all of the influence of American film and television and comic books. It's been going on for decades now. Infiltrated our culture, that's right.
But I think it's more sinister than that, because the people who run the Liberal Party campaigns are the same people who run the Republican Party. This is manipulation of an audience.
Yeah, it's not a national thing. Yeah. It's a global phenomenon.
Yeah, it is. And apparently in Vienna, they're just about to vote in the most right-wing fascist leader since...
He just lost.
Oh,
just
thank
barely.
God.
Yeah. Just barely.
Oh, thank God, because he was close, right? Because when I was reading about it, they hadn't actually, but they looked like he was going to get in. Oh, well, that's one little silver lining.
Next time.
But, you know, there's a lot of money.
Well, yes and no. I mean, there's a swing to the right kind of thing across Europe. And, you know, they're churning up the news and everything to achieve that result. But I think that, you know, we see in the polls and stuff like, you know, I think it's an empty vessel. I think that we see a lot of noise about that. But when it comes time to vote, people often make the right choice.
I hope you're right.
Either way, it was close.
Yes.
But the good news is.
Yeah, well, that gives you hope in, you know, things can get right to the edge and then people pull back and vote with their hearts or, you know, hopefully.
Well, you know, but it just presumes there's a lot of misinformation, right? So, and that's why we try to have media laws here that limit how many outlets one person can have in a particular territory. And that's why Murdoch has, power.
Yeah right?
Because he's got,
Well, you know, that's why he took American citizenship, so that he could have the same impact over here and take ownership of media here.
Yes.
Right? We need media broken out, like, you know, the interesting thing is that's, in theory, you know, and hopefully in fact, that's one of the things the internet has done, right, is allow all of these other voices to get some coverage, for other stories to get through.
Like us.
But we still have these basic problems of, like, over here they have all of these get out the vote campaigns, you know, with concerts and things like that. To get young people here to register.
I thought you said get out and vote. Yeah. I didn't realise when at first you were saying I thought it was discouraging people from voting, but I'm happy that they are actually encouraging people to vote.
So again, you know, as Bernie says, it's the Democrats here who are encouraging the young people to sign up and register. But what a lot of the complaints that you've heard in the last, you know, month or two here in the US of people feeling like they're disenfranchised and they're angry at the system is because in most cases, a bit like Australia, you have to register, you know, the date that you have to sort of register to vote is not clearly, it's not really stuck up on big posters all around town. And then when people come in to vote, they find out, no, you were meant to do something a few months ago so that you could vote today. So you know, this is one of the things in Australia. So, Bernie, you said it closed off last night, did it?
Yeah, 8 o'clock, wasn't it? 8:30 last night, that was the end of it. They tried to get that extended in the court, but the court blocked it. So,
So let me ask you guys, when did you enroll to vote? Because, like, literally the day after I turned 18, I went out and enrolled that the same day.
Yeah, same here.
I was wild.
Same
was,
here.
Well, you got in trouble back then, but now you don't because they don't want you in.
But to me, it was like it was you become an adult. You get your license and you vote. You know, I got my P's the day I turned 17, and the day I turned 18, I enrolled to vote. That was part of feeling proud about being a young adult. But I don't know whether there's the same sense of pride. I don't know because I'm in my 40s now, so I've got no idea.
You're not that old.
No.
So it's interesting. Even when I got citizenship here that afternoon, I walked across to the electoral centre and registered to vote. But I don't know. You know, it needs to be promoted, and to some extent, it's like, why do we need to enrol when voting is compulsory? Why isn't that automatic?
It should be automatic.
And Bernie,
yeah.
Were you saying that it used to be, and it's not anymore?
I don't remember.
But it should be automatic. It should be automatic, right? You're right. Yeah. What is this process of enrolment about?
I have to say though. At one point, I lost my license for riding the bike too fast, and so when you
pay, no, Bernie, yeah,
not our Bernie,
and then I yeah not me the bike's
he,
shed at
he
the moment.
He lost it for riding while asleep.
That's weird. Yeah, so and I'd let it go for a while. So when you pay that fine after you paid through, was it the Department of Collections or something.
Yep.
So I paid it, and then they say, no, you get your license back. You have to ring up the sheriff. There's a sheriff or something that looks at all of your past things that you've done wrong. So I ring this guy up, and he's got this list of felonies against, well, not felonies.
Misdemeanors.
But against my name. And he's going, you know, you didn't vote when you lived in Tookley. And I said, I don't even know where the fuck Tookley is, mate. And he goes, oh, that mustn't be you. I went, hang on. I said, my name's Bernie Zobber. There's only one in the world. Don't do this to me. I've never lived in Tookley. I don't know where it is. And now, so I said, who is this person? What's his address? And he says, well, I can't give it to you. It's private. So there's these lists, and I just couldn't figure it out. But apparently it happens. It's not quite identity theft, but it is. But people who want to do, you know, enroll or not do something, they'll just look at a credit list. So they probably were watching Cheese TV, right? And Stoner or something.
Wow.
And I go, oh, that's my name.
That's
right.
Odd, right?
And so apparently it happens a lot. Yeah. So there's this list of things that couldn't have been me.
Wow.
Right? But it's my name.
But people are just claiming it.
You know, like.
I mean, and the data gets dirty as well. Like, you know, that was probably someone called Bernie Pelvis, and you know, somebody typed it wrong, and then forever it's against your name.
Yes.
That's a really good point.
Work it out.
But it was a hilarious conversation. Like, I'm sort of feeling paranoid that there's all these things. Oh, there's a bit of a list here. And I go, what?
You know? Hilarious.
And I thought, what have I done?
They've done their intel on you, Bernie.
Funny. Yeah, it's all fake.
Yes. Marco, yes. Thank you so much.
Track of you, Bernie.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Is there anything that you or Penn want to let us know that's going on, or any other questions?
Oh, I do.
You guys
The doctor at Nauru, that doctor at Nauru who blew the whistle?
Yes, we were just talking about
him. He's Freedom of Information Act. He's found out that they've been getting his phone records. You know, that's kind of like America and the Republican Party, this kind of shutting down dissent.
Isn't that why Snowden left the country and was forced to leave the country? Because he actually fought against that?
The brief story of Snowden was that, you know, he was working in a cyber division for the military, and he stole their files, took them out, revealed them to show, because the military was sort of going, it's fine, don't worry, we're not tracking Americans, we're not keeping details on other people, it's all okay. And of course it was complete lies. And he revealed the information about it, and they were not happy.
Yeah.
And so he had to run to Hong Kong, and of course he's now in Russia. And the brilliant thing is that he's now doing keynote speeches at tech conferences, you know, not via Skype, but via satellite from Russia. So he's still getting to sort of do conferences and things like that, even though he's excluded from the country.
That's
but
awesome.
At some point, they're going to have to address that.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah.
Yeah.
whistleblowers are not loved here. There was a story just this week just talking about how the whistleblower protection laws are not doing their job in terms of protecting these people when they do something. And you can have the whole conversation about were people hurt, what was the damage, but it's still that basic thing that, no, people have to be able to bring the truth out to the citizens.
Wow, I love that.
Is that a general feeling you think? I would have thought that Americans overall would have been inclined to not like tattletales.
That's a bit different. Yeah.
It's an interesting conflict for libertarians that they're normally like, no, we want to know, completely transparent government.
I understand. Because the whole thing.
If there's a military side to this, then he's considered a traitor and unpatriotic, so everybody has to back away from him.
That's what I would have thought.
That's not a common American opinion.
Okay, well, that's good to hear. That's good.
Yeah. Marco, thank you for your just intelligence and your passion and for sharing it with us and for really giving us a really tangible understanding about what's going on in the States.
I'm glad to be of help.
And of course,
it's always great to talk to you folks.
Yeah. Oh, we love, and of course, a fantastic Penny who's holding the camera. Yep. Big shout out
and
to
you. Can you get the phone number of the guard?
There's Penn's hand. Oh, yeah, and Bernie wants to date. Was it Sheree?
Sheena.
What a great name.
All right. Well, you can do that off Gitgo time and territory, all right? Marco and Pam will tune in next week. Thank you.
See you, Marco.
Thanks a lot, folks.
Yeah, thank you.
Good evening.
Yeah.
Ciao. So interesting, huh? So interesting. Oh, I better do my job on the Skype. I'm really doing such a good job of it today.
Call
Marco,
Damien,
I need another. I've got this new, there's an upgrade, right? So everything I learnt last week, which I was going to implement today, has just gone out of the... Well, that's my excuse and I'm sticking to it, all right? Damien, we would love to talk to you too about apparently... Oh, I should have asked Marco. Apparently Obama's gone to...
Yeah.
Hiroshima.
Mm-hmm.
Is it Hiroshima or Hiroshima?
Yeah. Hiroshima.
Either or. Could you please Skype in? Lovely Damien. In the meantime, can I...
Off the grid living.
We want to talk off the grid. And can I also talk about this? This article appeared, right, in yesterday's trashy Murdoch...
Your ABC of Jibber.
All right, so this is an opinion piece by Tim Blair.
This will get all the rednecks riled. That's what they say. Look, I've done some shifts at Sky News and...
Yeah.
The journalists, they're freelancers, so they go around between different outlets, and they were just saying, the Telegraph, they have a meeting, and they just try and think of the most, angering title they can, and they just laugh and carry on. They'll get all the rednecks, they'll get all the Westies riled up. That's all they care about.
Disgusting.
Yeah,
that's
they
evil.
Think they just treat their customers, their audience.
Oh, with contempt. With complete contempt. And Tim Blair, and I want to be really careful here because a lot of people come down hard on him, and absolutely I understand why, but I do not want to stoop low to give any energy of anger toward this man. I just want to say his words because I don't really need to have an opinion on this.
He's just laying cables.
Yeah, right? He's laying cables.
Cables, yeah.
First of all, We showed the British poet, writer, singer. He calls her British lady rapper.
What was her name?
He calls her name's Kate Tempest. We showed her on Q&A.
You want to type in Kate Tempest?
We showed her on Q&A last week, and she did that fantastic spoken poetry. First of all, I hate that he calls her a lady rapper. And he also just basically talks about that everything she spoke about on Q&A, as well as everything her word poetry. Is that how you say word poetry?
Oh, there she's
spoken
there.
Poetry?
Spoken word.
Yeah. All of her spoken word, he claims, was completely ununderstandable.
Unintelligible.
Yeah, unintelligible.
Inarticulate.
Yeah,
drivel, all that kind of stuff.
It was poetry. So he wouldn't understand it. It's not the language.
The tragedy is he's claiming that a show like Q&A is... ridiculous, and it should go back to the days of having a variety show like the Don Lane show. Where celebrities came on and they were celebrities.
Don Lane.
Didn't have a political edge, and everybody seemed so happy. And so he's gone on here to basically defame Kate's art, her as a woman, and everything that she has to say. And in reading this piece, and it's a full page, I was really actually devastated to be an Australian.
The thing is the thing that annoys me a little bit is the fact that there are Australian poets, performance poets, that are writing stuff that is relevant to what's happening in Australia right now that are so articulate, so powerful, so dramatic and to the point. Why is it that a show like Q&A has to have a British person come on to somehow legitimize the political issues that are going on in this country. Why can't they have an Australian poet? I mean, I can think just off the top of my head of 10 or 15 that would have loved to have had a chance to be on that show and done their poems. Her poem was incredibly generic. It was about, kind of like how it is generally. But there are wonderful women poets and male poets in Australia, male and female poets in Australia, that are really pinpointing the issues and really talking about them in incredibly powerful ways.
But maybe it takes someone like Kate Tempest, who is very big at the moment because a lot of people are loving what she's doing and listening to what she's saying. Yeah. Should we listen to a tiny bit?
Oh, okay, a little bit.
Listen to a tiny bit again, just to remind people.
For the noose that sent the sinner off to sinner land and made us all feel better in the knowledge that the righteous would be right and just forever. Once there was religion and it ruled and we all had it bad. We fooled ourselves to sleep at night, said this was this and that was that. And if our morals ever shook, we looked no further than the book. But gradually we felt the pressure, it became the greater oppressor. And without God, the wars seemed crueler, life seemed stranger, art seemed foolish, death seemed bleaker now.
Okay, maybe it is gibberish. Maybe it is.
No, it's not. But I'm sorry, Tim Blair didn't understand what you said. It's not gibberish.
Yeah,
it's not gibberish. Do you know what it is?
He was just politicking, though. That's got nothing to do with poetry.
Yeah, I don't think
he doesn't give a shit, right?
Yeah,
he doesn't give a shit. He just wants to put anyone down who's an atheist because he's going to back.
Yeah, but also,
screw Tim Blair, okay? It's got nothing to do with it. He's really irrelevant to the discussion.
I suppose.
The question is Q&A, elected to have a poet come on and talk about real issues in the real world, and they selected a woman who does not speak for Australia.
It doesn't matter, though. They have a whole panel of international guests. And
that's
what's
she
so
could
great
be on that
it.
Panel. I don't mind her being on the panel.
Yeah, and she's a young woman, too, and it's really important.
I know young women Australian
poets. Thought she was only put on because she was touring. And
She was at the Sydney Writers' Festival.
She was at the Sydney Writers' Festival. But you know what? Maybe it takes someone like Q&A to start this. And to start
this. Nonsense. That's nonsense.
Well, they can come on Gitgo. Any fantastic
we'll do that. And we will.
Okay, we're calling all poets.
We
want a poet on Gitgo. Is anyone out there a poet?
In fact, contact Bernie through Facebook, Kenny through Facebook,
totally.
Or me through Facebook and say, we would like to be on. You can shoot yourself, send the files up, and we'll put you on.
I'm up to that. I wrote a poem.
Yeah.
Where is it?
Do it.
Where was it? It's on my other iPad.
Facebook.
In the meantime, I'm trying to get in touch with Damo, and I'm not having much success. So, Damo, if you are watching via Periscope right now, can you please Skype in? He did this last time. I was trying to Skype him, and all of a sudden I heard that.
Where was he?
Well, he's in Japan.
I know, but he was...
Listening on the toilet. And he knew that I needed him to call in. And we just assumed that he was on the toilet.
Teasing us,
Yes, teasing us. Yeah. All right, so in the meantime... Oh, I forgot to ask Marco about Yale. Yale University.
Yale.
All right, next week I'll ask Marco. Because a couple of weeks ago, remember we talked about in North Carolina, they were making a law that gender diversity was... If you were reassigned from your birth gender, you were not allowed to use the toilet of your chosen gender. And there's been a big debate about that. So Yale University has just come out saying 23 of the buildings on its campus will now be gender-neutral bathrooms. So that's really good.
But this is some kind of like big revolutionary thing or something.
That's the way
it never happens anywhere in the world. That's nonsense. You go into any public toilet anywhere in Paris, for example.
Anywhere.
And it's like...
It's all the same.
It's just the same.
Is that because of that's the way it's always been or because they're being specifically open and understanding of...
No, it's because my view is that America's got a real hang-up about things that have to do with toilets. And I'll tell you why. And the dead giveaway is they don't ever call them that. They call them bathrooms.
Right. Restroom.
Restroom, right? So, when I first came to Australia... In houses in Victoria, the toilet was always in a different room than the bath. It had a little closet.
I should have it in the kitchen.
There was an American came to Australia back in 1971, asked if he used the bathroom. They said,
Oh, as opposed to the toilet.
You want to take a bath or something? Or they didn't think what he wanted it for, but they directed him to the room that had the bath in it. And he ended up pissing in the sink.
Can you give me that keyboard? I want
that to. That is hilarious.
This is how we get to our access.
That's
here,
right. When I first.
Redneck. I'm going to get the redneck.
Oh, you
liberal,
get the redneck.
Right?
Yeah. Okay. So when I first went to New York, it was on my 19th birthday. Yeah. And I will never forget. And it was before Giuliani gentrified everything. So it was a bit, I stayed sort of Times Square, and it was really edgy and quite dangerous. I turned on the television and I was blown away by the number of commercials to do with your ass. If you have a problem going to the bathroom, try these laxatives. Or, you know, it was like everything to do with disorders of the bowel. I was beyond
hemorrhoids.
Shocked. Exactly.
Preparation
hemorrhoids.
I mean,
lumps
what,
on your ass.
Is that a metaphor?
They're sphincter rings.
Right?
That's what I call.
You know,
when you get calamari, that's what I call.
Well, can we not turn this very important issue into potty?
No, but we don't have to. You know why Americans refuse to use the word toilet?
Why?
Because it has the word toil in it.
Oh,
and they don't
work.
Want,
they don't work.
Yeah, they don't want to associate work
with resting in the restroom. It's a restroom.
Yes, it's
a restroom. that's
much,
it's
much
not a toilet
more
room.
Like, you know.
We want to see that redneck. Because liberal redneck. Have you seen
hilarious.
The liberal redneck?
Yes, I love him. In fact, he's my people.
He's your people.
He comes from where my people come
and
from.
Your people from down south.
No, not down south.
Where are they from?
West Virginia.
West Virginia.
Yes, sir, Bob.
Let's hear him. Here we go. Oh, get off the ad. Come on, you talk. Shut up, Miss Dad.
Look, they look at that. At least it's not a bathroom ad.
What's up, y'all?
We're going to do it again. Fired up, son. I've been seeing all these Facebook posts about transgender bathrooms, and every one of them comes down to the same shit. Well, hell, what's to stop some pervert from wrapping a skirt around his wiener and going in the ladies' room with my baby girl? I ain't having that. We gotta watch out for the kids. Meanwhile, these are the same motherfuckers that put Mountain Dew in sippy cups and put a six-year-old with a wire hanger standing in front of the TV during Dr. Oz.
I don't get that one. You'll have to explain it.
I don't know.
What do you think is gonna happen? You do know that transgender people have existed forever, right? What bathrooms do you think they've been using? And how many times you ever hear about what you're worried about happening? Hardly not, never. Because even people that aren't child molesters are not going to prey on a kid in broad daylight, in public, especially not with their mouth-breathing troglodyte daddy 12 feet outside the door just dying.
Right, get out of him, yes, boy.
It don't make no sense.
Fresh meat.
And what about little boys? The vast majority of people that prey on little boys are adult males. This all don't affect them one way or the other. So unless you're also suggesting that we have separate bathrooms for Catholic
priests.
Quit being a pussy and say what you mean. You're freaked out. With all the man wanting to be a woman disgusts you. Because like most things that disgust you, you lack the capacity to understand it. You know, homos, algebra, shit like that.
Shit like that. That's so funny. He's good, isn't he? Yeah.
We have seen this before, haven't we? Yeah. But I got more out of watching it again.
Yeah.
And it was maybe because Billy was on my left just pissing himself laughing the whole time.
They're people, my cousins.
Yeah, come on.
They're people, my cousins.
Now what is... you explain to me, what is the thing of reference about... put the Mountain Dew in the cups. What's that all about?
Lemonade.
It's lemonade.
Mountain Dew is the sweetest drink you can buy.
So you just think you're
baby
sugar,
It has more sugar per
honey.
Square inch.
Okay, so the sugar...
Than any drink you can get, but he talk about Dr. Pepper.
Okay, what about the coat hanger wire reference? What's that all about?
I just tuned out with that.
I'd have to hear that again. I missed that, boy. I'm not
Do
that
Do I have
fast.
To listen to that one again? As much as I love him,
hey,
I don't
we
think
We got to get the Driver Brothers.
We're the Driver Brothers.
We're
the Driver Brothers.
I don't think I can do that again. I'm going to get Damien.
Come on, Damien.
Please, Damien.
It turns out he's actually...
he's
actually a comedian.
No, he's brilliant.
Yeah,
we do need... Come on, Damien.
Michael Tolstra.
Why do I do that all the time?
What do you do?
I'm trying to get...
Oh, look, there's a redneck history of America. We want to see that.
Where are you, Damien?
Damien.
I
want to
hear some culture from Japan.
I thought his internet
was... I want some culture.
Yeah.
From the place that I was
and
at.
And you know what? He's actually obsessed with American politics as well.
Yeah, he is.
He's up all night.
He is. Where
you
is
know
he?
What? Why is it such a good show? You know, Yeah, the because Bernie Salamander. Bernie Sanders is the most popular candidate of all time.
Yes.
And he's against the most unpopular candidate of all time.
Yep.
And they're going to win.
Well, it does.
You know, it's like, this is not a democracy.
But it does make you wonder if he might not run as a third party candidate. And I'll tell you, I would have thought that that would have been the death knell for any hope of liberal politics in America. But in this case, I actually think he'd win.
Yeah.
Really?
That would be great. I think,
Mark talked about it when he said they're the most hated candidates in the history of American politics. That's all you need. 47% of Democrats hate Clinton. Trump. 50% of Republicans don't ever want to see Hillary. You put those two together.
Wow. Coming up the sideline.
Because
Sanders.
It's the year for electing somebody that is not affiliated
with mainstream.
So this is the year. But Sanders could pull it off.
Oh,
yeah.
But,
wouldn't that be wonderful?
Yeah. But, you know, I don't know that he will. I think what he'll do is probably try to influence the platform, the Democratic platform, and he'll wrench some kind of deals out of them to make her, you know, program much more like his would have been.
You know what's interesting is here, if there is a parallel, it would be the Greens.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And both Labor and Liberal really give them a caning that they don't deserve. They're not that bad. You know, the shit you hear about them is just bullshit. Right. It's bullshit from Labor and Liberal.
I know.
Right. So they just don't want to. You know, they're all playing the same game. They don't want to let another player in. They don't want a democracy.
But listen, the Libs have been doing it right from the very beginning, as far as their association with the Country National Party, the National Party. I mean, the coalition is the coalition. It's made up of two parties that could never individually ever be elected.
That's right, because they don't have enough support. In fact, it's a deal with the devils, both of them.
A sweetheart deal.
Wow. Yeah. I didn't think about that.
Because they've both got not enough support. See, that's the point.
Can I ask
you
why?
Know, so it's not a democracy. No. What they do is it's a bully.
It's a
bully-mocracy.
Game of politics. Can I ask why you're so anti Hillary Clinton? Because there's a lot of conspiracies out there. And I listened to Gloria Steinem last week, who was in Australia, talking about, she's very close, you know, the very famous feminist, very close to Hillary. And she talked about it as being quite an anti-female, like they're very much of the, you know, the bullying of Hillary or the...
She backed the Iraq war. She's backed a lot of the really bad policies. And they're really wealthy. They're basically Republicans.
You know, was she just part of a process? Was it actually Hillary? Because it sounds like she's copping flack for decisions that were not necessarily hers as such. You know what I mean?
She's done enough speeches. And she flip-flops all the time. Mind you, I don't actually think, you know, changing your mind in politics is that bad, as long as you don't do it often. But she does it often. So.
But isn't it okay to change your mind if you get more information about something, or if you can be a bit more empathetic because you learn something? Why is this whole changing your mind? What is it, shows that you're not strong enough or something? I don't get it.
Yeah, they have this word for it, flip-flopping.
That was
what did Kerry, and you know, he was a flip-flopper.
Yeah, and it's meant to be a derogatory term. It
sounds means
like
that you have no true convictions.
Yeah,
that you just go with the wind. You know that you're not. You had lack strength.
Strength.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right. Well, what do you think about Hillary?
I just wonder why she won't release her speeches.
Yeah.
Because that's a dumbass thing to fight about.
Yeah.
If there's nothing there, why not just say, yeah, this is a speech I made to Wall Street. This is the one I made to Sachs. This is the one I made to such and such. I mean, she doesn't want to release them because probably the same reason that Donald Trump doesn't want to release his tax returns.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, because they have things in them
that she doesn't want to have to answer to. She's backing the bankers. She's protecting them. So, you know, and she made $600,000 an hour, something like that, was it, one of the speeches?
Yeah, like that.
To Goldman Sachs. She's protecting them.
So
she's the establishment. She's just a little bit slyer, a dog, than the rest of them.
Right.
But, you know, is she preferable to Trump? It would appear so.
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
But that doesn't mean.
But I don't even believe anything Trump says, right? No. He's just a showman, yeah. Right? He's just going, oh, look, someone's voting for me. I don't even think he intended to take it this far. And then, of course, it all went out of control. No. And, you know, and I'm like, well, okay, well, we'll go along with it. And he's just having a ride, right? That's all he's doing. Yeah. I don't think he would do a lot of those things he's saying.
I noticed that Palmer is getting out of politics.
Who?
Palmer. Oh, Clive.
Yeah. Clive. Well, it's the same kind of thing, yeah. Isn't it? You know?
Hallelujah.
And what does that say about politicians? I mean, here's a guy that got bored.
He got bored.
Yeah,
he's
it
bored.
Only took
he's
him
a bored millionaire.
Right. So does
it
that
wasn't
say,
what he thought it would be.
Does that actually say he has more intelligence than the average politician who can go on and on and on for years and years and years and seemingly never get so bored?
Well, here's the thing. I don't think he's got... See, Malcolm Turnbull's a great one. So when he got defeated by Abbott, right?
Yes.
He tail between his legs. He said, I'm out of politics. I'm out of here, right? And he takes off.
I'm going to try demo again.
And then he humbles himself and comes back. So you have to ask why, right? So there's two possible... No, the guy's wealthy, right? Yeah. In fact, I remember back then when we were talking about this. The guy doesn't need to be there.
No. Yeah.
Right? So it's something a lot bigger than wealth.
Yeah.
You know...
By George, I think we got him.
It was look, there is Damien.
And so I've got I'm full suspicious. Screen. I've got full screen you. Hello. So it's
nice lighting. What have you done?
No sound.
Hello. Thank you for Hey, did you hear me on Periscope going, Damo, can you call in? Damo, can you call in?
Can I call in?
No, did you hear me? Were you watching us on Periscope?
We've been calling you on the Periscope.
I was trying to get a hold of you and I'm so glad we can see you. How are you?
Good.
We mentioned, we're all good. We mentioned earlier that Obama went to Hiroshima this week.
He hasn't been here yet.
Oh, he hasn't been here. When's it happening?
Next week, I think.
And what's the general vibe about that in Japan?
Okay. The story is last week in Okinawa, there's a huge U.S. military base in Okinawa. And they've been having problems with it due to the fact that last week one military personnel raped and murdered a girl. And this is not the first time this has happened. So this is not the first time this has happened. And so a lot of people in Okinawa are going, hey, you know, this is wrong. And then they get taken by the U.S. military, put them back in on base because it's U.S. soil. Give them a slap on the wrist and back to the US you go.
Do they get put in prison or do they have a trial once they go back to the States?
No one knows because it's US military, so nobody knows what goes on.
That's right, and you don't want to be blowing the whistle on those guys, do you?
No, right.
You know what happens? They turn you, they put you in a dress and they put you in jail.
Mm. Oh, like, like, what are you talking about?
Yes,
what are you got mad?
No, WikiLeaks, you know.
Oh, WikiLeaks address. Sorry, anyway,
He didn't really want to change transgender. He was made to. Sorry, it was
a bad
joke.
I've got no idea what's going on between these two. Back to you, Damien.
And so, like, everyone's saying, hey, it should be we want an apology from, and for, like, 24 hours, the US and especially the Obama coming, it was like, freak out. And so the U.S. ambassador being Kennedy, so I just went, yeah, whatever. We might have a meeting, we might not, you know, who knows what's happening. Oh, but then it becomes, they brought on this meeting, Kennedy, and she's sitting there in a chair, and she's talking about the dolphin killings in Japan.
Oh, the dolphin and killings, that, yeah. Well, I'd like to talk about that.
Everyone's gone there to talk about the soldiers, and it's like the dolphin killings. We don't like the dolphin killings. It's like, everyone's just gone.
So needless to say, where are American-Japanese relations this week?
Oh, they're horrible at the moment.
Really?
This is a hilarious story about the dolphins. She talks about the dolphin killing. Yeah. I mean, really, I mean, Damo,
And the funny thing is, like, you know, like, the US is like, you know, Obama shouldn't apologize for the, you know, Hiroshima and what have you. Mm-hmm. And everyone in Japan's going, yeah, it's so obvious. Why should he apologize? You know, in Japan, it was like their feeling was, well, it was war. We lost. Oh, well, let's move on.
Yeah, wow.
Yeah, that's an interesting thing.
You have lots of people, especially in the US, the older generation that were in the Second World War. I know from personal experience with my wife being Japanese, we went there, and the racism towards her because she's Japanese, and that's why at Pearl Harbor they have two separate boats that circumnavigate around it. One's for the Japanese only, one's for the foreigners and the Americans and that. And my wife has had racism from, well, why are you here? Why should you be on this boat? You know, you guys started the war, blah, blah. And it's like,
I'm surprised that they had two boats. They could have. I would have thought they would have flown the Japanese in and by plane, in keeping with the historical. Sorry.
That's a history joke, right? Now you want to be smart.
Between the history and the, what are you, transgender jokes? I mean, I'm like,
it's a bit like word association, right? But when you just make political association, it's actually quite ludicrous. You know, things are really nonsensical.
Absurd.
Yeah, it is absurd.
Yes. So, Damien, because we've been a very particularly politically heavy show today, can you just tell us some kooky Japanese stuff the fly?
Give me some of your kooky Japanese stuff.
Kooky Japanese stuff.
That's not racist.
Like what's big on telly, what's happening there.
Well, what do they wear on their heads?
Just fun stuff, because I'm feeling a little bit heavy from all the politics. Yeah. But I can walk away for a while and come back.
Go.
A good show that my daughter and I watch every Monday night is a show called Scut Japan.
Scut. Is that what?
Not scat.
Okay.
And
Skype. I blame the Skype. You know, Skype will bring the end of the world. Trust me.
Burn stuff.
And because you'll have, it's like a situation comedy where they'll do a skit about something that happens in real life. So people will complain about their bosses because their bosses are this certain way, or this type of customer is this type of way. So they'll do a skit about that, but then this customer gets slapped around, backhanded by something. Like someone will, like some guy yesterday went like this, and a bit of hair fell into his soup. And he goes, "Oh, look, there's hair in my soup." And then you'll have some guy behind him going, "I saw it. I saw you doing it." And it's like, this guy's freaking out. It's like, then it becomes the customer's fault, not their fault. So it's this sort of wacky, wacky comedy.
It's like a reality show, yeah?
Yeah, it's like a reality show, like based on real things that happen. And people sort of like, the show is based on like, you write in a situation, and if you get picked, you win, you get given like $300.
That's good.
Wow.
$300, hey? Yeah.
Right, okay, I like it. I like that kookiness. And I've
sounds like what we've been doing this morning.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. It's true.
We are pretty extreme.
We're pretty kooky and really political. Hey, I've also been sprouting off the statistic all week about Japan having 90% of their cars being electric or hybrid-based cars. And like a lot of Australians, really, like just friends I've been chatting to, like so shocked and so impressed, you know, with what's going on. And I'm really loving learning what's happening as far as and how advanced Japan is. Any other stuff you can throw at me so I can, you know, go off and sprout my mouth about good stuff from Japan?
Backwards? We're not that backwards.
No, we're backward as far as like our, you know, like Australia. Are you talking about you in Japan or us in Australia?
No, Australia.
I'm actually editing something for you guys at the moment about a recycling.
I'm looking forward to that. Recycling.
Yeah. That these people make things out of like, let's say it's an old tree, like a thing that's broken, and he makes hats, whole wooden hats out of like tree trunks. Or this other person that gets all the broken glass and makes light shades, and person who makes wooden pens. Like, you know, if someone like they demolish a house, he takes the wood and makes pens out of the wood. So and all these crazy...
You know, they tried to make a Japanese out of wood, but it wouldn't work.
Oh, Burnster.
Yep.
You're on Love. A roll.
Yeah, and so they tried to make a steel, but steel wouldn't work. That's an old joke, yeah, but...
An oldie, but a goodie. Mm.
And so, like, and at the next one I've got on is all about the electric cars and all the electric stations.
Yeah,
so
I love it.
Do that one up next.
Okay, good. Keep us tuned in. Anyone want to ask Damon any questions before we
sign
up for the day?
Where were you before?
Oh, yeah, when I was trying to call you.
Oh.
Where were you?
No, it's dropped out.
Oh, Okay. Oh, friggin' Murdoch and friggin'...
And you're destroyed.
Turnbull and friggin' Telstra and everybody.
You look really good now.
Yeah, you look great, good mate. Yeah.
Hey, we look forward to receiving your little video. Video on the recycle.
I think you've become infected.
Don't become a whistleblower.
Oh.
Okay.
We want Damo. Yeah. Damo is our whistleblower.
Is our whistle. Blow your whistle. Blow it hard. Oh, I should have.
And on that note, we love you, Damo. We look forward to receiving the video. Talk to you next week.
See ya.
Bye. Ciao. All right, guys, I reckon we've just about...
I think I've probably got the cops onto me now.
What meds are you having? What are you having? Anyone got meds? Can you put the thing back above? Anyone got any meds?
Meds? You know... Yeah, some people take those things, don't they?
I know, it's really quite tragic. Sometimes I'm watching television. There are two reality
shows.
No Drug of the Nation. There are two reality shows. One of them is House Rules, and the other one is MKR. And I think, Bern, can you please get the...
Okay. I was hoping if I faded away, I'd get out of this.
No way. And sometimes I think when some contestants are doing like video diaries at the end of the day, I genuinely think they've been given meds.
Oh.
I don't know. Well, I mean, they might be taking their own meds. Or maybe they're just tired, but it's
That
really
means like
odd.
Taking pills and stuff, doesn't it? I thought it was like pads. What? Let's not go there.
Let's just cut.
Because I had the whole thing wrong.
What wrong?
You put meds with.
Meds. Oh,
medication.
Benny?
Yeah.
Yeah. He thought they were TEDs.
Oh Lord. Oh Lord. All right. On that note, I'm saying nada. Thank you for tuning in.
Yeah.
Bye.